Dear Lord, I just thank you tonight for the message that you have given me, Father. And I just thank you for this week, and I thank you for these people, Father. And I truly especially thank you for what you are preparing us for. I just pray that as we grow each week, each day, each minute, that you continue to strengthen us, that you continue to open our eyes and our hearts and our ears for the calling that you have laid upon our lives, Father. I ask all of this in the precious name of Jesus, that you bless each and every one of these lives within this room, their families, their friends, and outside of this room, Father. I thank you and I give all the honor and glory to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So anyway, it was kind of neat because, first off, we all know Darren and Lisa wasn't here last week. So I don't even know if I was blue and correct after what I said. Darry is 100% true that we have, when Alicia's here, we know if we're off course a little bit, she'll steer us right back on a little bit. She's a biblical scholar, basically. I mean, she studies the Bible, which is kind of, you know, which is really good. But it was kind of neat because when I went home, I mean, did anybody get blessed last week?
Yeah,
I did too. I was blessed, and especially afterwards. And I, you know, just the power of the presence of the Holy Spirit that I felt. I mean, obviously, I broke down right in the middle of it. It was just still so powerful on me. But to see my wife, it was funny because we're laying in bed and she jumps up out of bed. And then she goes and gets her Bible and she comes back in and she goes, "John, you're going to explain this one to me." And I'm like, "Oh, gosh, I'm glad Alicia wasn't there because if I screwed this up." but it was really kind of neat because I was able to show her what God showed me. But I just thought that was neat. It really made me think throughout the rest of the week of the things that we hear when we come here on Wednesday night, when we go to church on Sunday, you know, how often do we try to go home and really study those for God to speak to us through what we were shown or whatever it may be, so that God can give you His individual message from Him. And I just thought that. So I really tried to. So when I was talking to Darry, we were talking a little bit about last week and about some other stuff, and we started talking about the message. And I tried to tell him what the message was. All I could remember was transformation. I'm like, man, I can't even remember what I said. All I know is at the end of it, man, all things broke loose and it was on. You know, I'm just like, it was, you know, I got to share an experience LaDonna had standing up here and stuff. It was just an amazing blessing. So I'm just honored to be back up here this morning.
This morning?
I'm honored to be here. I was going to say I'm honored to be here tonight because this morning I was really, really, I knew what I wanted to talk about this week. I kind of pre-limited last week. I wanted to talk about, you know, once we learn about transformation and about, you know, when we give our lives to Jesus and how we start to transform and stuff like that, then, you know, I wanted to lead into purpose. So I kind of known throughout the week what I want to say, but this morning I started really getting up just trying to, trying to prepare myself for it. And God led me somewhere I've never been before. I've been there, but I've never shared from there. And that was the Message Bible. Now, I've always kind of glanced over. I have an app on my computer that I study off of called the Olive Tree. And I have about 12 different Bibles on it, you know, and commentaries and stuff. But so I always like to flip back and forth. But, you know, every now and then I'll go to the Message and, just kind of skip through it. But when I was going through these notes, he led me to the Message Bible. And when I read it, I was just like, holy moly. It was incredible. So I don't know if no one in here has a Message Bible. Is that correct? They're mostly just King James Version, New King James, and NIV. Yeah, so
I read them. I'm a homie.
Yeah, well, the reason I say that is because I read it in the New King James Version. I read it in the NIV, and I read it in the Message. And they all, you know, they said, but the Message just stood out to me on purpose on this. So, and there was about 4 or 5 weeks ago, Darry prayed over a lot of us, all of us that were in the room, one by one. You guys remember that? I know some of you guys were here. When he came to me, I knew it was a word from God. Because about, I don't know, 7, 8 months ago, I came across a drawer, and I opened it up. It might be wrong with that. I know I think I've shared this once, but I found every single one of my notebooks and folders that I had from the day I went to prison to the day I went out. You know, so 4.5 years full of studies and things I would write down. And I kind of looked through a lot of them because I was looking for when God first gave me the acronym Moses one day, that was about the only time. Well, when he prayed over me, he said something into the essence of, God wants you not to forget what he showed you in those four walls, and that you have everything like a blueprint already there. I didn't know what it meant, but I knew that there was a reason that I had found all that, and that it sits out in my office to this day. So that's what I've been trying to go back over. That's where a little bit of the transformation came from. That's where all of the purpose came from. So as I was going to go through some stuff I wanted to share with you guys, he brought me to the Message Bible, which leads us into our verses, and it's almost the whole message is from the Message scriptures from the Bible, and I have some things to share with you that God gave me on purpose a long time ago. So, you know, hopefully God shows through me what he showed to me, and that you walk here with a little bit of, you know, a different mindset on your purpose, or finding your purpose, or what your purpose is. Some of you may already know, you know, your purpose, your calling, whatever you want to say. So I'm going to start out and read in Ephesians chapter 1. This is going to be verse 3 through 10. And please remember, I'm reading out of the Message Bible. So if you don't have a Message Bible, what I would like for you to do is let me read this to you. Don't try to follow it in your Bible. And then write the scriptures down in your book so you can go back and read it in whatever version that you have, so that God can show you. Does that make sense? Because it's really, and you'll see what I'm talking about, the difference between the two versions. They're real similar, but I think you want to read the Message Bible a little bit more. I know Joyce Myers preaches out the Message Bible a lot, but I just thought it was really kind of neat. So I'm a new King James Version. I'm not as educated as Gary. I can't do the King James Version, but God told me as long as I'm in the new King James Version, I can still go to heaven too.
That's Darren about that one.
Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 3.
Chapter 1, verses 3 through 10.
Yep. Okay, so here we go. How blessed is God? And what a blessing he is. He's the Father of our Master, Jesus Christ, and takes us to the high places of blessings in him. Long before he laid down earth's foundations, he had us in mind. He had settled on us as the focus of his love, to be made whole and holy by his love. Long, long ago, he decided to adopt us into a family through Jesus Christ. What a pleasure he took in planning this. He wanted us to enter into the celebration of his lavish gift-giving by the hand of his beloved Son. Because of the sacrifice of the Messiah, his blood poured out on the altar of the cross, we are a free people, free of penalties and punishments chalked up by all of our misdeeds, and not just barely free either, abundantly free. I had to read that part like 3 or 4 times. I love being free. I really love being abundantly free. He thought of everything, provided for everything we could possibly need, letting us in on the plans he took such delight in making. He set it all out before us in Christ, a long-range plan in which everything would be brought together and summed up in him. Everything in the deepest heaven, everything on planet Earth. So, in verses 1 through 10, we see basically that God had everything planned a long time ago. He already had a purpose set up, not only for what his overall plan was, but for each and every one of us, you know. If we go on a little bit further and read in verse 11 and 12, it says, it's in Christ that we find out who we are and what we are living for. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, I thought that was really cool too. Isn't that cool? Anybody else catch that? That's me. You know? So basically what it said, long before we heard of Christ. So when we heard of Christ and we started hearing the wonders of Christ and this and that, we got our hopes up. He had his eyes on us. So long before we heard of him, he had his eyes on us, had designs on us for a glorious living, part of the overall purpose he is working out in everything and everyone. So I just really kind of dove deep into that today and just really tried to meditate on it. And just, man, when you let that sink in, it's kind of incredible to know that, man, no matter, I don't want to get too far ahead of myself because I'm on the top of this, but just, it doesn't matter. Everything is designed for a purpose, you know? So when we, you know, when we gave our lives to Christ, he's beginning to fulfill that purpose. Now it's up to us to walk in that calling. But back, one of my favorite scriptures, I've shared this one time before, but this is the scripture I live by. This is the first scripture that God really showed me when I was in prison that I really kind of stood on light, because for those of you that I was able to share on that, you know, it was always very discomforting to me to know when I read that God had a plan for me, you know, how I could end up where I ended up. You know, so he had to show me how, by my own choices and by my own free will, that where I was, what his plan you know, for my life, but that all he could make it work out from the plan. So it was kind of amazing. So he brought me to Jeremiah 29, of course, 11. I'm going to read 11 through 14, okay? Jeremiah 29, 11 through 14. This is all out of the Message Bible time. I know what I'm doing. I have it all planned out. Plans to take care of you, not to abandon you. Plans to give you the future you hope for. When you call on me, when you come and pray to me, I'll listen. When you come looking for me, you'll find me. Yes, when you get serious about finding me and want it more than anything else, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. God's decree. I'll turn things around for you. Exactly. I've never read that verse. As long as I have looked at that verse and all that, I have never read that verse in the Message Bible.
What verse and is that?
29:11-14. Yeah, matter of fact, every plaque, everything that I have, that's like, it's what Donna can't ever think of, but you have to give me the skills and store reminds me something with Jeremiah 29:11. I've got pins and necklaces and, you know, statues and everything, so I love it. So keep them coming. But I've never read it in that version before, and I was just like, wow. You know, especially the part, that last part I read kind of leads into, there's a remaining part of verse 14, but I just wanted to end it there where it says, I'll turn things around for you. You know, so all the way back in the Old Testament days, here is God, you know, telling the prophet Jeremiah that, you know, I have plans. I have plans for you. And then it spoke again, you know, in Ephesians, and Paul wrote that book, correct? Yeah. Paul?
Ephesians?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
I didn't know you were asking me, so.
Okay, is my eyesight off? I was going to hurt. I was going to hurt. I don't care. It's like, okay, so now here's what's kind of crazy. So Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 through 12, I read. Then it led me back to the Old Testament, to Jeremiah 29, 11 through 14. Then it led me right back to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. So, and that says, it's in Christ that you, once you heard the truth and believed it, this message of your salvation, found yourselves home free, signed, sealed, and delivered by the Holy Spirit. This signet from God is the first installment on what's coming, a reminder that we'll get everything God has planned for us, a praising and a glorious life. Wow. You know what I mean? Like I said, I want you to write the scripture down because I want you to go and read those and that thing. Because the way it hit me today was just incredible. You know, and I'm going to be 100% honest. You know, I told you guys last week, in different stages of our life, we're always battling with something, it seems like, right? You know, no one ever said becoming a Christian, things were going to be hunky-dory, life was going to be grand, right? But it did say that God would give us the strength to get through any trials and tribulations that we had. I told you that one of my, oh yeah, I guess I'll hear this, I remember this. Yeah, you were here last week. There was some freaky stuff going on. But I told you guys last week that one of the biggest demons I've battled in my life and one of the biggest, you know, spirits I've battled in my life is the spirit of addiction. That spirit had me bound for a lot of years. But when I learned that the truth had set me free, that spirit no longer had any power over me. And really no other spirit does. That don't mean I still don't have to battle day by day. I still have those little demons like to pop their head up. No longer is it an addiction. You know, a spirit of addiction. I mean, I could go to places I could have never even gone before because I would have relapsed. I can go to those places now. The day that God freed me from that addiction, I never had to go to an NA meeting, an NACA meeting, AA, whatever, all the meetings in the world. Matter of fact, I was told I was going to fail because when I went through a program, I smiled the whole way through because 3 days after I was there, I knew where I had missed the boat. I knew where I had missed the boat, and that's because I didn't put God first in what I was doing. So I smiled all the way through the program, and LaDonna could not do this thing. My counselor told me, you are going to fail when you leave here. And it was in our one-on-ones we had with her. And I'm like, LaDonna, you know, she's worried. So why'd you say that? Because no one goes through rehab for 90 days, or was it 30? 30 days and smiles the whole time. They're hiding something that they're not wanting left. That was her words to me. She told me that specifically. Well, in this specific program, and you guys remember this 8-9 years ago, how long ago it was, in this specific program, they had a thing where when you left, you made a coffee cup, and you hung it up on the wall. And on your year of sobriety, you could come back, you get to take your coffee cup home. They had a wall also to where people who didn't make it and died of their addiction in that first year, they had what was called a black wall or something, so there was a whole wall for the cups.
But LaDonna and I, after that first year, made our trip back to Hall State, Kansas, and I stood up there in front of a group of about 30 people, and that same exact counselor was right there. And I looked at her, and I looked out, and I said, "I'm still smiling, and I want you to look behind you," because no one else in this room was smiling. You know, so I gave them a message of hope. To be, it's okay to be happy when you're being released, when you're being set free, when you start to find your purpose. It's okay to be joyful, no matter what circumstance you're in. And it changed my life. And I am still that. I did not. Once again, the reason I brought that up is because I did not have to do any kind of special, you know, anything when I was released from addiction. When God finally set me free from that, when I believed I was set free, I could walk into the hood, I could walk straight through a crack house, as God is my witness, and not even think twice about doing it. I could go in there preaching the word. You know, I mean, that's just, now, I'm not stupid. You know, I'm not gonna go move into a crack house. but anyways, so.
Praise God.
I love for life, but I know a lot of fools is looking to be crazy the first time we walk in on Sunday. Especially when LaDonna said, "Oh yeah, an armoire hit in the head." They're like, "Oh yeah." We got a pastor AD come up to me talking about something we need to talk. Okay, that ain't even half of it. Like 4 days later, she's in the laundry room, all I hear is this scream. Ah! I'm like, "What's going on? My other eye, I'm just kidding." I'm like, that is a true story. I'm thinking to myself, there is no way in the world anybody's going to believe this. You know, I mean, there's some people, Derry, Jeff, a few people that I might say that know me from a long time ago, you know, this and that, and a little hot temper, that might think, "Hey, you should
have spoken."
You got my back? Okay, awesome. So anyway, I just thought I'd share that because it's been horrible. I wish the thing would go away. Put my hands on my knot tonight. Because even last Sunday, people didn't see it the first Sunday. Yeah, it was all me and last Sunday. Don't say that. You know, look. Alright, so anyway, this kind of leads into, so here's the deal. When you start walking into your prayer, walking in your calling, walking in your purpose, God said He already had everything laid out for you, already had everything planned out for you, right? We just read that on the scripture, correct? And even when you read it in all the other versions, in some way, shape, or form, it basically says that God has had, has planned everything. Okay, when you start to walk in that, when you start to follow that, I asked myself a question, and this is coming out of some of the notes from many years ago, and one of the questions I asked myself was, how does God provide when you embrace your purpose? And the first thought that came to my mind, and the first word that God put in my heart was miraculously. See, we think it's a miracle when it happens, but God's already planned it. So it's truly not a miracle, but we think it is. I said miraculously. But God said to me, when you start to embrace your purpose, He's already made the way. So it's truly really not miraculously. It's already there. I just start walking it. It's almost like we're going through life sometimes. God, I wish God would bless me. I wish God would bless me. God's got the blessing over here. He's just like saying, "Fool, I'm not going to come over to where you're at. You're going to come to me. I've never left. I'm in the same place." You know, it's kind of funny when you start walking. You know, if you're walking in a straight line, and if you just, every 10th step, just scoot over like a half an inch. And if you do that for 500 steps, you're going to be way out of whack. You follow me? So it's kind of, that's some of the stuff He told me. But He also led me into something that I thought was kind of cool, because Derry shared about this a few weeks ago. And I've kind of tried to go over a lot of stuff Derry has taught over this past year. And
Not grace.
It's funny, I came across some about grace to do. It was really funny. It was in my notes. But a lot of stuff Derry's preaching is, I don't know yet. What the true purpose and plan is for Moses and the church. But I do know that God has blueprinted everything I've done. When I have watched some of Derry's messages back, and I've been going through a couple of my books, I'm finding things that God had told me all those years ago, almost word for word, what Derry speaks sometimes.
You follow me? And you know how sometimes Derek will have a message and then we'll have to open it up, how it interacts. So there's, God has blueprinted this thing out many years ago, and I'm so excited to watch it unfold. You know, whatever that may be. I know what he showed me in a few different areas. So I'm awesome. But here's the deal. Did I just say I'm awesome?
Yeah.
Meanwhile, the moment we get tired in the waiting, God's Spirit is right alongside helping us along. If we don't know how or what to pray, it doesn't matter. He does our praying in and for us, making prayer out of your wordless sighs, our aching groans. He knows us far better than we know ourselves, knows our pregnant condition, and keeps us present before God. That's why we can be so sure that every detail in our lives of love for God is worked into something good. God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. He decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. The son stands first in the line of humility he restored. We see the original and intended shape of our lives there in him. After God made that decision of what his children should be like, he followed it up by calling people by name. After he called them by name, he set them on a solid basis with himself. And then, after getting them established, he stayed with them to the end, gloriously completing what he had begun. So what do you think? With God on our side like this, how can we lose? If God didn't hesitate to put everything on the line for us, embracing our condition and exposing himself to the worst by sending his own son, is there anything else he wouldn't gladly and freely do for us? And who would dare tangle with God by messing with one of God's chosen? Who would dare even to point a finger? The one who died for us, who was raised to life for us, is in the presence of God at this very moment, sticking up for us. I thought that was pretty cool because you guys remember the analogy I talked about last week, where, you know, I always take things sometimes back to the criminal justice department.
Yeah.
And, you know, God is our advocate. He's our lawyer. So as, you know, the devil is accusing and adjusting and this and that because when our sin, you know, and God has to judge everything. Jesus stands up and says, hold up, I paid for that. You know, so always look at Jesus as my lawyer. It's kind of weird. But it says right here in the Message Bible, in the scripture, that he is at this very moment sticking up for us, saying, hold up, wait a minute. He belongs to me. I paid the price for his sins. Do you think anyone is going to be able to drive a wedge between us and Christ's love for us? There's no way. Not trouble, not hard times, not hatred, not hunger, not homelessness, not bullying threats, not backstabbing, not even the worst sins listed in Scripture. They kill us in cold blood because they hate you. We're sitting ducks. They pick us up one by one. But none of this fazes us because Jesus loves us. I'm absolutely convinced that nothing living or dead, angelic or demonic, today, tomorrow, high, low, thinkable, unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced us.
Amen.
Right. Right. The Message Bible will preach to you. You know,
I thought that was pretty incredible. But
so after I would read all that in the Message Bible, I would go back and I would read it. First off, in the NIV, because I know most of you have an NIV Bible here, so I wanted to see what you guys would be reading and possibly following. And then, hello, how are you?
Welcome to the promised
land.
So I'm going to read it in the NIV, because because I knew that's what most of you guys read. And then I would read it in the version that I usually study, the New King James Version. So it was really kind of interesting just to see the similarities, but also see the differences in the translations, but how each one of them spoke almost the same message, but in a different meaning. Is that maybe right? You know what I mean? Because I was reading, getting the same message, but I guess I was getting the same meaning, but in a different message. So I just thought that was incredible, because I had read that scripture 100 times in the New King James Version. Right? You know what I mean? And Derek preached about it a couple weeks ago. And I just thought it was kind of incredible to really sit back and remember that, you know, I don't have to look at just certain pieces in my life. If I focus all the time on my prison years and just dwelled in the sorrow of how much time I've missed out of life or whatever it might have been, until I realized that God took that and turned it into good for me, and it is because of that I am where I'm at today. You know, I give, matter of fact, I used to get, not really reprimanded, but I remember one of my bosses telling me one time, Shannon, what are you talking about being in prison and stuff? Because I had no shame to tell people I had been to prison. And he was just like, no, it's not that. I just got to tell myself, man, you just don't understand what God did for me while I was in prison. And that's all I knew, was I had found a relationship with Jesus Christ while I was in prison. So prison to me, how do I say this? Wasn't a bad place. It is a bad place, but for me, it was not a bad place. It was a training ground for God and me, for me to get closer. I always believed in God. I remember as a young kid sitting on church pews one time, or church stairs one time. I don't know if I get that's when I gave my life to Jesus or not. I just remember being there. So my true remembrance of truly turning my life completely over to Jesus was in prison. But I always believed in God, but I never had a relationship. That's what prison made a difference in my life. So I used to tell people about it all the time. That, and I guess it was the meaning of being free. You know, not that I was only free from prison, but I was free from a lot more than that. So he truly took a bad and worked it together for my good. So it was an amazing time. But as the years have gone, this is probably one of the only places that I share openly about that, unless I'm actually ministering to somebody or giving a testimony. You know, it's still part of my life, but it's not everyday conversation anymore. Because as the years go, sometimes it gets harder and harder to remember.
You have better things to talk about, other things.
Yeah, I mean, I've had other testimonies and other blessings and other miracles in my life. So, but I guess, you know, here's some things out of my notes from the time that I spent inside prison I wanted to kind of share with you guys to maybe help you understand, you know, purpose in your life. There is, it doesn't matter where you're at, what you've been through, where you're going, there's a purpose for you. So don't look at the rejection, look at the direction. Okay? Don't look at the rejection, no matter what that rejection may be, look at the direction. Don't design yourself after one phase in your life. Now, I thought that was pretty good. That's kind of goes back to what I just said about being in prison. Don't design yourself after one phase in your life. You see, here's the deal. You are right on purpose right now, okay? Whatever is going on in your life is God strategizing. So if you're in this room, and I know most of us, if not all of us, I'm assuming all of us, believe in Jesus. We have given our lives over to Jesus Christ, okay? We are believing for bigger and better things, so God is strategizing. So if you are going through hard times in your life right now, don't live off that one phase. It's God strategizing the plan. Understand, God wants to use you sometimes, but you're trying to use Him. Okay. It's hard for me to try to explain that, but maybe I want to let God maybe give that word to you on meaning. What is the meaning of me trying to use Him? You know, how many times do we find ourselves praying when we're in trouble, but not rejoicing when we give Him a blessing? Right? I thought that was an amazing, amazing testimony. And the reason I say that is, because sometimes, once again, it's easy to say, oh my God, I tithe and I got $1,000 check in the mail, right? But that had nothing to do with receiving money. So that was an incredible testimony. I think God works all kinds of things. I don't know, who would be calling me during Bible study?
Coda?
No, my mama. I should answer and say, put up a FaceTime. But this is she did that last week too. Mom, do you know, never have a little bossy mom? We all know my mom, but I'm telling you. Hey, now I never hit my mom. I used to be a bad kid. She used to wait till I got hurt, or at least wait till I wasn't watching. Like I knew something bad, right?
And she would say nothing to me. Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm talking about.
What? Mm-hmm. Then I'd be sitting, I mean, one time I broke my leg. And she came up behind me one time, took my crutch and hit me. And I said, what was that for? She said, remember when you smarted off 3 weeks ago? You should be there all the time, I'd be in trouble, and she wouldn't do anything. I'm like, that's not bad, right? But like a week later, out of the blue, she just walked up to me and just catch me off guard, because if she, I knew I was in trouble, she couldn't catch me, she tried to, I'm like, what? So, she figured it out, you know?
She looked so mad at you again.
She did. I had a broken leg, cast up to here, and smacked me right in the crutch. 2 weeks after I broke it.
Anyway, God wants to use you, but you're trying to use Him. Here's the one thing you have to understand. This is another big, valuable thing that God showed in prison. It's kind of cool that He is the potter. I talked about this a little bit last week, and we are the clay. I want to read a couple scriptures. Isaiah 64, verse 8. Once again, this is another message. Still, God, you are our Father. We're the clay, and you're our Father. All of us are what you made us. If we go to Jeremiah, chapter 18, verses 1 through 2.
Oh, I didn't tell you the freak out thing. I'm sorry. When we were talking about, battling some spirits and stuff like that, I start freaking out because I'm talking about it and everybody back here is like this, looking over there. And I'm just like, I kept on going for a minute. I was like, what in the world are you guys staring at? They're like, you didn't see that? Like, no, the lights start flickering.
Yeah.
I was talking about like evil spirits and stuff, and then all of a sudden the light goes.
That's okay. That's got to be some wild heads that lawyer does. Anyway, Jeremiah 18, 1, verse 10. Thank you.
What?
Jeremiah 18, 1, verse 10. 1 through 10.
I'm
awesome. Another one of my favorite scriptures in the whole Bible. This is another one of the scriptures that got me through four and a half, 55 months in prison. Because it's easy to look down on yourself, you know. I was never scared or fearful when I was in prison. It's kind of weird. Not that I was Mr. Really Bad Blood or anything like that. I just knew that I had a protection on me. Yeah. You understand? They're there. Hey, there's a big old hole, isn't there? It's inappropriate, about us. I just knew that I was protected, right? But there was times when I was alone, and I was sitting in my cell, and I would think about my daughter, or I would think about Madonna. Madonna, we were friends when I went into prison. We fell in love when we left. I used to date her a long time ago. She was my older sister, the best friend. My sister is my older sister. She's a couple years older than me. I was just a white boy that could dance. So I kind of was a little better than you're off. Anyway, 11 years down the road, here's my daughter. And she became my friend, knew nothing about my addiction. She learned about it real quick. We fell in love with letters. But there was times when I was lonely and I would go to that scripture and God would remind me that I was, you know, show me the potter who gave you the scripture. So I'm going to read it to you. God told Jeremiah, up on your feet, go to the potter's house, and when you get there, I'll tell you what I have to say. So I went to the potter's house, and sure enough, the potter was there, working away at his work. But whatever the potter was working on turned out badly. That sometimes happens when you are working with clay. The potter would simply start over and use the same clay to make another pot. Then God's message came to me. Can I do this just as the potter does, people of Israel? God's decree. Watch this potter. In the same way that this potter works his clay, I work on you. At any moment, I may decide to pull up a people or a country by the roots and get rid of them. But if they repent of their wicked lives, I will think twice and start over with them. At another time, I might decide to plant a people or a country. But if they don't cooperate and won't listen to me, I will think again and give up on the plans I have for them. So it just really made me, gave me, gave me comfort to know that even though I was marred, that he was making me anew. That he was not just going to discard me and start to build something new. He would take what he had already created and keep shaping until it became perfect. I've lived on that scripture for a long time, and I just am so thankful for that. So today I'm asking you, what is your passion? Because God uses your passion sometimes to bring you into your purpose. So if you just think about it, I used to sit and think I was about to leap into my purpose. Everything I almost begin or I start, whether it was in the car business, with my Salus, with the many things I've tried, with the stuff right now, with the new business we're getting ready to start, I just know that I'm leaping into my purpose. You know, I know that God is strategizing some things for what Madonna has called and some callings he had put in our life, that everything he has just unfolded a lot of stuff. So, but I have to tell you sometimes, though, that when you start to leap into your purpose, it takes you out of your comfort zone. Amen. There's a higher call in your life, and if you're willing to make the shift, God is going to open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing you will not have room enough to receive where we were at before. These are notes that I used to have in my thing before I really started, and then when we started Moses, the very first scripture I came across for our blessing time was in Malachi, and that was it. So when I read that today, I was like, wow. You know you're in a purpose when provisions just begin to happen. I stand true on that every day. You know when you're starting to walk in your purpose and you start seeing, it's almost like God, I pictured this one time, it's like God, actually I heard TJ say this one time, that God, as you're starting to walk in your purpose, kind of like how he said, he's kind of over here, he's like, I'm already over here, but when you begin to walk in that purpose, he just starts dropping out these little blessings. He starts dropping out these provisions, because when you're walking in his calling and what he has designed a purpose for you, he is going to provide everything for you for that calling. So that was kind of cool. But you know you're in your purpose when provisions just begin to happen. So here's what I'm asking you. Just pray on your passion. Believe in your passion and that you have already received it. Whatever God has for you, he will give you the desire to want it. The clue is in the desire. The pursuit of your life is to come into your purpose. The waste in your life is to miss your purpose. But Don and I was at an event one time years ago, and we were listening to Miles Monroe, and he asked the question, can you tell me where you would find the most hidden talent, the most purpose-driven people, the most talented people, the best in everything there is.
The richest place in the world.
Where would you think it would be? And if you know this answer, if you've ever heard this, please don't say it. But if I was to ask you that question, if I was to ask you where the richest place in the world is, where would you think that would be? Anybody? The cemetery. The cemetery. There are so many people that were buried before they ever found their calling. There's so many authors that were never discovered. So many dreams that were never reached. There's more potential laying in a graveyard, unreached potential laying in a graveyard. It was amazing how he said it. It just really made you think of how, basically what he was saying was, don't miss your calling in life. Don't die. So what I have in here is, the pursuit of your life is to come into your purpose. The waste of your life is to miss your purpose. Remember, your story holds clues to your purpose. If you accept this, if you accept that your story, your path, holds clues to what your purpose is, that you will stop grieving over the things that went wrong in your life. Everything about your past is fitting into a purpose. What may look like a disaster in your life, no matter if it was in the past or today, is really a direction. So when you tie that together with where you're going in life, where you've been in life, and understand that we've already read in Scripture that God uses everything to work out for the good, for his purpose. And I've already read that God loves us so much that nothing can get in between that. So understand that anything bad that is happening in your life, Lily, understand that when you get to the end of what you feel is your road, it's not a disaster. It's a direction. You jumped out of my spirit so hard today when I read that. And I don't know what it is, young lady, but you must have a high calling on your life, because the devil is on you like Christ. But you have the strength. He's already been defeated. So
look at stuff now that it's not a disaster, it's a direction to where he wants to take you. And that's for all of us in here. But I knew it was specific for Lily when I first read it today. So I'm going to close with just a couple things so we can get to enjoying some cookies, have about 15, 20 minutes, and then we'll talk about Kev.
That's a real timeline. We finished at 8 o'clock last week.
I read something out of, not a big Rick Warren fan. I do think he's got some very valid points and a lot of stuff he does, but he does believe in Jesus Christ. But he had written that book, Purpose Driven Life. I've never read it, but I was doing some research on purpose today, just trying to see some different things, get some ideas and stuff like that. And kind of when I was reading my book, I was trying to make sure that that wasn't going to get too badly corrected anything. I'm just kidding.
Poor Amicia.
I know, that's so funny. I read this, so this is one thing I found, and then when I looked into it deeper, I found that it was from Rick Warren. But it was five purposes. And I don't know if that's what his book is designed off of, five purposes or not, but I thought it was really cool. And he said, here is five purposes that God has really planned out for our life. So it says, we were planned for God's pleasure. So your first purpose is to offer real worship. I thought that was kind of cool. Offer real worship for God's pleasure. We were formed for God's family. So your second purpose is to enjoy real fellowship. Fellowship just is not inside the church walls.
Amen.
Fellowship is anywhere that you go. You know, and to show the love of Christ through you wherever you're at.
What was the second one? Formed for God's what?
Family. So we are to enjoy real fellowship.
Amen.
The third one, we were created to become like Christ. So your third purpose is to learn real discipleship. In order to become like Christ, we have to know who Christ was, who Christ is. And, you know, how do we learn that? By reading his word and letting him speak to us. We were shaped for serving God. So our first purpose is to practice real ministry. Ain't no room for fake Christians. I'm just going to say it, you know.
What did you say?
Ain't no room for fake Christians.
Oh, ain't no room
for I would say, watch the tape.
There's like so many titles on
them. We might just have to skip and say, hey, watch it. So your first purpose is to practice real ministry. And we were made for a mission. Fifth purpose is to live out real evangelism. Okay? You don't have to be an evangelist to evangelize. Anytime you speak the name of Jesus and you share your testimony and you share your story and you lead someone to Christ, that's evangelism. A couple days ago on Facebook, I read something and I thought, wow, what better way to close out showing that God has everything in order. And that everything that happens to us, bad or good, is for a reason and it's for a purpose. So I just wanted to read it with you to give you a hope, to keep your hopes up, so that when you go home throughout this week that you can think about each and every day. And guys, here's what I would like to ask you. Darren and I talked about this yesterday a little bit, and we're trying to design some outlines, some stuff out, you know, on some different stuff. You know, meditate on these things. Meditate on your calling, on your purpose, on maybe some of the stuff that maybe you might have wrote in your notes today. And if you come up with questions, you'll share, you know, Facebook. You know, put it on our Facebook page. Let's get some conversations going. You know, we have a Moses Facebook page. We have our Moses group. A lot of prayers in there. Been a lot of good testimonies in there lately. But let's bring some positive light to it. Let's, you know, start discussing some of this stuff. So, I read this on Facebook, and I'm sure it's probably a pretty familiar poem, but what better way to close this night?
Oh, Gary.
What's up?
Yay! One more.
Want to get a spot?
So, me. God, can I ask you a question? God, sure. Promise you won't get mad. I promise. Why did you let so much stuff happen to me today? What do you mean? Well, I woke up late. Yes. My car took forever to start. Okay. At lunch, they made my sandwich wrong, and I had to wait.
on the way home, my phone went dead, just as I picked up a call.
All right.
And on top of all that, when I got home, I just wanted to soak my feet in my new massager. Did LaDonna write this?
No.
I just wanted to soak my feet in my new massager and relax, but it wouldn't work. Nothing went right today. Why did you do that? God, let me see. The death angel was at your bed this morning, and I had to send one of my angels to battle him for your life. I let you sleep through that. Me, humble. Oh. God, I didn't let your car start because there was a drunk driver on your route that would have hit you if you were on the road. Me, ashamed. God, the first person who made your sandwich today was sick, and I didn't want you to catch what they have. I knew you couldn't afford to miss work. Me, this time, embarrassed. Okay. God, your phone went dead because the person that was calling was going to give false witness about what you had said on that call. I didn't even let you talk to them so that you would be covered. Me, softly. I see, God. God, oh, and that foot massager? It had a shortage that was going to throw out all of the power in your house tonight, and I didn't think you wanted to be in the dark. Me, I'm sorry, God. God, don't be sorry. Just learn to trust me in all things, the good and the bad. I will trust you, God. Oh, and don't doubt that my plan for your day is always better than your plan. Wow. I won't, God. And let me just tell you, God, thank you for everything today. God, you're welcome, child. It was just another day of being your God, and I love looking after my children. Amen.
Amen.
So, that was on Facebook like a week ago. I don't know if you've seen that, but when I read it, I printed it off. And today when I was studying, I had this book, which was really weird. And, you know, some of these are my favorite books. When I pulled it out, I was like after I finished, I pulled it out, I was like, wow. You know, so I wanted to close with that because I wanted you to understand that everything that you're going through, as long as you have faith and you're building upon it, okay, there is for a purpose. God makes all things, both the good and the bad, work together for good for those who love him. Amen?
Amen.
So tonight when you go home throughout your week, if you wake up late tomorrow, if you're late for work, or if you don't get that chill, or by God your car don't start, whatever it may be, understand that there's a purpose for it. And look up to heaven and give God the thanks for whatever it is that's happening in your life.
Amen.
Because everything is for a plan and a purpose. Amen?
Amen. Amen.